The US is sanctioning a lot of countries right now. Russia, Venezuela, Iran, North Korea, Syria, Nicaragua, Cuba. When the US imposes these sanctions alone, which is often the case, they're technically called unilateral coercive economic measures. The US is the only country that thinks it has this sort of universal jurisdiction to financially crush anybody anywhere with sanctions, because the US controls the world's economy thanks to the dollar. The intended purpose of these sanctions is to coerce the government of the targeted country to change its behavior to America's liking, or to make the population suffer so much that they overthrow the government for the US. Sanctions might seem like a nonviolent way to make governments do what we want. That's why even our favorite and most progressive members of Congress often end up voting for them. But in reality, sanctions are an admission that you have no policy, but you want to take what you think is a moral stand. So you put an entire country under siege. Sanctions are violent, sanctions kill, and sanctions don't work, unless the goal is in fact to bring a nation to its knees. They're a form of collective punishment through economic sabotage. You could even say economic terrorism. Once sanctions are imposed, even targeted sanctions, it ruins the economy because no investor wants to get involved in a country that's under sanctions and risk costly legal penalties for potential violations. So they turn self-sufficient countries into aid-dependent nations, destroying their industries which can't function under sanctions that make it impossible for them to participate in the global economy. They hurt the most vulnerable, poorest people in society, causing food and medicine shortages that lead to disease and death. And they often empower the very regimes they're supposed to weaken by making them the sole provider for a desperate population that can only think of its daily subsistence. Let's start with the most recent country to come under brutal US sanctions, Venezuela. The mainstream press has given lots of airtime to stories about the very real economic crisis that's caused some 3 million people to leave Venezuela. They blame the economic crisis on the government's mismanagement of the currency and falling oil prices. What they don't tell you is that US sanctions helped cause this crisis and have made economic recovery impossible. The sanctions prevent Venezuela from restructuring its debt, importing food and medicine, and they block Citgo, the US-based Venezuelan state oil company, from accessing its profits. The sanctions, which were imposed under Obama and then intensified by Trump, are so draconian, they're literally killing Venezuelans. That's according to the first UN rapporteur to visit Venezuela in 21 years. He said sanctions on Venezuela are so severe, they amount to crimes against humanity.
Commercial interests throughout the world are afraid to have anything to do with Venezuela. That amounts to virtually an economic blockade.
The sanctions have been cranked up in recent months, with Trump's national security advisor John Bolton announcing that the US will freeze Venezuelan assets and block billions of dollars in oil payments. Venezuela has the largest oil reserves in the world, and the US is the largest purchaser of that oil. 95% of Venezuela's export revenue comes from oil. So cutting off the government's access to dollars from oil will literally starve the economy of hard currency needed to pay for imports of food and medicine, which could create a humanitarian catastrophe. If it sounds like theft, that's because it is. John Bolton admitted as much.
Venezuela is one of the three countries I call the troika of tyranny. It'll make a big difference to the United States economically if we could have American oil companies really invest in and produce the oil capabilities in Venezuela. It'd be good for the people of Venezuela. It'd be good for the people of the United States.
It's all about the oil, baby. It's the resource curse. Economist Mark Weisbro put it this way. How does a country with 500 billion barrels of oil and hundreds of billions of dollars worth of minerals in the ground go broke? The only way that can happen is if the country is cut off from the international financial system. Otherwise, Venezuela could sell or even collateralize some of its resources in order to get the necessary dollars. Despite all the suffering this is causing to average Venezuelans, liberals are still cheering on the sanctions.
Again, I want him gone. Like, we should all be very clear, like, this would be good. I do think there's a different way to go about this, which is to be tightening the noose, to be tightening sanctions.
Do you support the sanctions?
Adios. Yes, I support them.
Wouldn't that hurt ordinary people?
I think we need sometimes to demonstrate that Mr. Maduro has hurt ordinary people every single day.
The US is obviously trying to create a humanitarian crisis in Venezuela through sanctions, so it can then use that crisis as a pretext for intervention to overthrow the government, all while pretending to care about delivering aid to Venezuelans, which is an obvious PR stunt.
The cost of this blockade is over $30 billion, and they are sending this so-called humanitarian aid for $20 million? So what is this? I'm choking you, I'm killing you, And then I'm giving you a cookie?
Not only is this immoral, it violates international law. That's according to the UN Office of the High Commissioner of Human Rights, which says military and economic coercion cannot be used to overthrow a sovereign government. Venezuelans aren't the only victims of these policies. Syria is still suffering the wrath of US sanctions after years of fighting against a US-backed regime change attempt. The Syrian government was under harsh economic sanctions throughout the war, making it extremely difficult for desperately needed aid to enter the country during what many were describing as the worst humanitarian crisis since World War II. A leaked UN Commission report labeled the US and EU sanctions on Syria as some of the most complicated and far-reaching sanctions regimes ever imposed. The civil war, fueled by the US and its allies, combined with the strict economic sanctions, have plunged over 80% of Syrians into poverty, up from 28% in 2010. That's in a country that was once self-sufficient in food and medicine production, but today is entirely reliant on outside aid that's difficult to access because of sanctions. And the West is only tightening the noose, adding more sanctions, making it impossible to import chemotherapy drugs or obtain replacement parts for medical equipment like dialysis machines. 10% of people suffering from kidney failure have died as a result of these sanctions. A recent US Treasury advisory blocking petroleum sales to Syria led to a fuel crisis at the height of cold winter temperatures, meaning people couldn't heat their homes or access cooking oil. The sanctions also make it impossible for Syrians to rebuild the cities that the war turned into rubble. The same West that was hysterical about the Syrian military besieging insurgent-held neighborhoods is now besieging all of Syria, as if the 16 million people there are to blame. In Iran, the poor are also bearing the brunt of sanctions on oil, which were reimposed by the Trump administration. The Financial Times reports that millions of Iranians are suffering because the sanctions caused the value of the rial to plunge more than 70% against the US dollar over the course of a year, leaving the most impoverished struggling to pay for basic goods, such as meat, dairy products, and fruit.
The sanction is very bad, maybe make many problems for Iranian, for medicine, transportation, for insurance.
We don't have to speculate about what these sorts of sanctions do to countries in the long term. In the 1990s, the UN, at the behest of the US, imposed crippling sanctions on Iraq that were so deadly that at least two senior UN officials resigned in protest. One of them, Dennis Halliday, even used the word genocide to describe the sanctions. The US continued to rationalize the Iraq sanctions even after a report was released by UNICEF in 1999 that showed the sanctions had caused the death of more than 500,000 Iraqi children under the age of 5. And what was the US response to the death of so many babies?
We think the price is worth it.
For those who have no moral dilemma with causing so many babies to die, consider this. Sanctions don't work. The US thinks sanctions will drive such a huge wedge between the government and its people that the people will overthrow the government. But that's never actually happened. In fact, the leaders in sanctioned countries do just fine. It's the people who suffer. The sanctions on Iraq starve babies, not the Iraqi leaders America wanted to oust. Sanctions on Syria are empowering the worst and most corrupt impulses of the regime, as a recent investigation reveals. The so-called smart sanctions are not smart. They create and empower oligarchs who, when targeted by sanctions, double down, become more powerful, and multiply in number. In one of the most comprehensive studies on sanctions to date, 4 academics examined more than 100 cases of sanctions and determined that they were only partially successful 34% of the time, and only when the goal is a modest one, meaning not regime change. The US trade and travel embargo on Cuba, for example, lasted for more than 5 decades and never succeeded in overthrowing the government like the US wanted. The same goes for North Korea, which even produced nuclear weapons capabilities in spite of sanctions. Basically, using sanctions to overthrow governments doesn't work. It just hurts poor and vulnerable people. Yet the US keeps on doing it. People keep suffering, and liberals go on patting themselves on the back for what they think is noble, but is really just downright vile. Because sanctions don't work. They kill. Or maybe that's the point.